For centuries, people have been finding something both scary and fascinating on beaches around the world. Take a look at this. Yeah, this is huge, both literally and figuratively, as it's some of the only evidence we have of the largest shark that has ever lived, the Megalodon. From teeth like this one, we've been able to learn a lot about these 20-meter-long sharks that ruled the ancient seas. We know that they ate marine mammals and fish, we know that their closest living relatives are lamniform sharks like makos and great whites, and we know that they absolutely went extinct about 3.6 million years ago. But we're just beginning to find clues that help us answer the most pressing question. What made Megalodon so freaking big? Now, you may look at this tooth and think, that's the biggest tooth I've ever seen, but it surely isn't the biggest Megalodon tooth that exists. This one is about 12 to 13 centimeters long from root to tip. The largest Megalodon tooth ever found was at least 18 centimeters, and there may be bigger teeth out there that we just haven't found yet. But why does tooth size matter to us? Because it helps us estimate the size of the mouth it sat in, and therefore the size of the shark it belonged to. And recent estimates of the Megalodon size put this shark around 20 meters long, roughly the size of a tennis court. So with teeth like that one, researchers are able to estimate how big the jaw and therefore the entire shark was. And this is all based on comparisons of this same information from sharks that swim in our waters today. Specifically, sharks in the order Lamniformes, the same order that the Megalodon is in. Keeping things in the family. Why are we so focused on teeth for Megalodon research? Well, sharks are boneless fish. Their entire skeleton is made up of cartilage, which is softer than bone. Soft parts like skin, fat, hair, and cartilage don't fossilize very well, so it's rare for them to show up in the fossil record. Teeth, on the other hand, are very hard. And for sharks, they're plentiful. Sharks can go through potentially thousands of teeth in a lifetime. Thousands of teeth for every individual shark for a species that existed for millions of years equals boatloads of teeth for us to investigate these prehistoric creatures. But we gotta address the elephant in the room. Or rather, the 20-meter-long shark in the fossil record. Why did they even get that big? One reason could be simply to eat bigger prey. Being bigger means you have options. While the Megalodon is believed to have eaten mostly smaller prey, such as baleen whales around 2.5 meters long, it was also likely that they were able to gulp down 8-meter-long whales in 5 or so bites. That's the size of a modern orca. And we know all of this because of, say it with me now, teeth! When a Megalodon bit into its prey, like whale, and hit bone, it left evidence of that bite mark in the fossilized ribs of that whale. Marks like that provide evidence for their ability to eat both small and large prey. Being able to go after a wide variety of prey is useful. Even if you're eating mostly smaller animals because that's what you encounter more often, it's nice to have a bigger meal when you get the chance. I don't know about you, but as much as I love a good snack, I'm always excited for dinner. Endothermy, or the ability to regulate its own body temperature, may have been another reason the Megalodon got so huge. Okay, pause. Aren't fish cold-blooded ectotherms that can't regulate their body temperature? Also, how can you even tell that a Megalodon could regulate its body temperature just from looking at teeth? I'm so glad you asked. First of all, most fish are ectotherms, but not all of them. Some of them are endotherms, or at least regional endotherms, meaning they have a way of retaining heat in part of their body. For example, some of those lamniform sharks related to the Megalodon are regional endotherms, including the white shark, mako sharks, and the thresher shark. And Megalodon teeth have revealed that they may have shared this trait with their living shark relatives. Scientists used a technique called clumped isotope analysis to figure this out. By looking at the presence of certain isotopes in the teeth that formed at different temperatures, they were able to estimate the Meg's body temperature and compare it to the known seawater temperature at the time. And the results suggest that the Megalodon was able to keep its body temperature, or at least the temperature in its head, higher than that of surrounding water. Because metabolic rate decreases with body size, active lifestyles aren't common in large animals like Meg. That's why the largest animals in the sea, like whale sharks or baleen whales, are often filter feeders. But being able to elevate its body temperature would have allowed Megalodon to increase its metabolic rate again, allowing for an active, predatory lifestyle. Hence, Megashark. Regional endothermy would have also allowed the Megalodon to venture into colder environments to look for food because they could retain heat, which explains why we often find their fossils at high latitudes. Speaking of latitudes, let's talk about Bergman's rule. This is the concept that things get bigger with latitude, but it's more about how different environmental factors tend to change as you head north or south, including temperature. The idea is that animals tend to be bigger as temperatures get colder, because larger animals have smaller surface area to volume ratios, meaning there's less of an area to lose heat. So, they retain lots of heat and are able to survive in colder climates better than smaller animals of the same species. Now, this rule isn't really much of a rule since it definitely doesn't apply to all organisms. In fact, data consistent with this rule has only been observed in one shark before, the star-spotted smooth hound shark. Say that 5 times fast. Until recently, when scientists suggest it could apply to the Megalodon.
Thanks to Policy Genius for supporting this SciShow video. With Policy Genius, you can find life insurance policies that start at just $292 per year for $1 million of coverage. Some options offer same-day approval and avoid unnecessary medical exams. It's easy to put off things like life insurance that don't matter until they really matter. In fact, 40% of people with life insurance wish they'd gotten their policy at a younger age. And once you hear about companies like Policy Genius that help you through every step of the process, you'll have even more reasons to put it on the top of your to-do list. Policy Genius lets you compare quotes from America's top insurers in just a few clicks to find your lowest price. And their licensed support team can answer your questions and handle your paperwork for you. So you don't have to keep putting off life insurance. You can make it easy with Policy Genius. Head to policygenius.com/scishow or click the link in the description to get your free life insurance quotes and see how much you could save. That's policygenius.com/scishow.
To figure this out, scientists looked at fossilized teeth in different parts of the world, when those teeth were most likely deposited in the fossil record, and the estimated sea temperatures at the time. After doing all of that, one study suggests that the larger individuals were found in those higher latitudes and colder temperatures. So those 20-meter-long megs probably weren't hanging out around the equator. But megalodon fossils have been found all over the world, including what is now California, Florida, Peru, Panama, Spain, Chile, and more. In fact, their teeth have been found on every continent except Antarctica. Today, fossilized teeth and a few fossilized vertebrae are all that's left of our megalodon friend from millions of years ago. But we do find big teeth from other sharks still living in the ocean, and they can help us learn about the meg. For example, great white teeth aren't quite as big, but they're definitely not trivial in size. And great whites may have even contributed to the downfall of the megalodon. Once white sharks arrived on the scene, the Pliocene, they may have overlapped in diet with the megalodon. In combination with the changing environment, competition with the white shark and other large predators is thought to have contributed to the megalodon's extinction approximately 3.6 million years ago. And yes, the extinction definitely happened. The only part of the megalodon still hiding somewhere in the ocean are teeth from individuals that have been dead so long that they had time to fossilize, meaning all the organic material in the remains have been replaced by minerals, essentially turning it to stone. Nature turns things to stone much slower than Medusa does. But is bigger always better? Like, could this type of unreasonably sized shark evolve again? As I mentioned earlier, the megalodon was a lamniform shark, and there are 15 lamniform species living today. In some of those species, we do see regional endothermy, like we believe occurred in the meg. But we don't see Bergman's rule applying to today's sharks. They don't get bigger at higher latitudes, so maybe the way back when times just had the perfect set of conditions for creating a mega shark longer than a bowling lane. For a shark scientist like me, it's kind of a bummer to know I'll never see a living megalodon. But for marine animals who might have ended up on the meg's menu, and also surfers, maybe the extinction isn't such a bad thing.